يا شباب، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. جيت كل وزراء يا شباب، تو مي جيت كل وزراء عادي ايه اراوند مي اوفر هير. يا حمزة، يا حمزة، جيت كل وزراء يا حمزة. هير ذير ار سام سبيس اوفر هير، هير حبيبي، يو دونت هاف تو ليد يور باك، كم هير، يو ار تو يونغ فور ايه فور ليدينج يور باك. يس، because our sheikhs يعني to find small spot to sit down, this is a you would appreciate this blessing. Now here you are sitting and leaning your back. Get closer حبيبي, get closer. يلا الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. يا إبراهيم أعرض عن هذا. I don't see you إبراهيم. كيفك يا محمد؟ محمد make sure إن شاء الله don't take إبراهيم and يوسف and leave تمكين early without letting people know and without letting me know. I know that you leave Tamkeen early on your own many times before without letting anyone know you decide to leave and leave without asking anyone. But at least, يعني إيه, don't ruin the manners of Ibrahim and Yusuf. Make sure they stay till the end of Tamkeen. There is value. Do you know the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever he said, يعني إيه, even in Taraweeh, you know the hadith, من صلى حتى ينصرف الإمام. See the smartness of each hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, how he discouraged people from leaving the salah before the imam. And he started to set up the reward for those who stay till the imam would finish the salah. I would use the same concept, ya Muhammad, and tell people. And it is you and nor other people, but at least do not ruin the manners of of the younger generation. There is value in staying till the very end of the program and helping in the cleanup, not whenever يعني إيه I got the food, يا الله سلام عليكم. I was well fed and I'm leaving. يلا let me share with you يا شباب يعني إيه some chat regarding few خاطرات. Mainly these خاطرات came during the last girl hike that we did in the middle of nowhere. Do you remember where we were hiking last time? What was it called? Where you were trying to come and rescue us. It was in the middle of whatever it is. It was in the middle of nowhere. And usually as it is a tradition, I give khatira before the hike. And I ask for people to give me khatiras after the hike. And I really ask for the khatiras to be deep. I don't know if you are maintaining the same concept, ya shabab. Many times I have to go, يعني إيه, to give protection for the girl side, يعني. So, and I leave my young men, they can protect themselves. So I hope you are maintaining the same culture, ya shabab, in the hike. For I was telling them as my khatira, should I leave everything and come live here by myself in the middle of nowhere? We found some people camping, putting their tents just on their own in the middle of nowhere and camping. So I was asking them, when would it be the time to leave everything behind, even to leave Tamkeen and close Tamkeen and just take myself on my own, go somewhere where I talk to nobody and nobody would talk to me. Just to stay by myself, maybe get my RV and then close Tamkeen, find a fully remote job, work from my RV and see nobody.
Is that what you want?
Yeah, this is what I'm discussing in the Khatira. Yes, many times I'm thinking of this actually. And just live by myself, not talking to anyone. خلاص بقى my kids are getting older, I will ask يعني the older ones to take care of Yasin and then سلام عليكم. You will not
with and many alone
حبيبي for sure. Is it many times I even tell Jasim find me an RV from an auction so that I take the RV and no one would know where I am. So that was, and I was telling them, when would be the time to do this? When would be the time to say, yalla, let's close Tamkeen and salamu alaykum, or leave Tamkeen back to the admins and just live by myself? And even today, my khutbah, it was actually in Monroe, and I came here after my khutbah. I was telling them, when would it be the right time to give up? Or for an imam to tell the people, I'm staying at my home, I will never give you a single lecture after today. I'm just staying in my home. When would that be the right time, shabab? This is the question I was sharing with the girls in the khatira. Then, I was telling them the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the story starts whenever one of the tabi'een was asking a companion about an ayah. And this is actually the ayah I recited in the second rak'ah in Maghrib. So I read, يعني from, it was the context in the first rak'ah, and then I read the ayah in the second rak'ah. The ayah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا عَلَيْكُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ لَا يَضُرُّكُمْ مَنْ ضَلَّ إِذَا اهْتَدَيْتُمْ. Oh, you who believe, عَلَيْكُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ, just take care of yourself. لا يضركم من ضل إذا اهتديتم. Those who go astray will never cause harm to you if you are on the straight path. Did you get the ayah? Or you who believe, عليكم أنفسكم. Take care of yourself. You are responsible for yourself. Those who go astray will never cause any harm to you if you are guided. So the tabi'i asked the companion about this ayah. And the companion responded back to him and said, you asked someone of knowledge about this ayah, because we asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as you can imagine, they were under the impression of, I just take care of myself. I don't need to care about the community. I don't need to care about the people. This is how the companions understood the ayah, and they wanted to double check with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Alaykum anfusakum, just take care of yourself. Those who go astray, they will never harm you. For they were asking the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, khala, should I give up on those people that we keep telling them answer the quiz and they do not answer the quiz? Probably they didn't have the quiz during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Sorry. This is whatever something came from the inside. Should we drop the ball on the people and we just focus on ourselves? He ba sallallahu alayhi wasallam responded, no, بل ائتمروا بالمعروف وتناهوا عن المنكر. No, enjoy the good and forbid the evil. Enjoy the good and forbid the evil. حتى till. And here is where, يا شباب, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم will tell us when to stop. He صلى الله عليه وسلم told them, till you see. And then he gave four signs. One, two, three, four. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told the companion, if you see these four things happening, فَعَلَيْكَ بِخَاصَّةِ نَفْسِكَ. So the default, ya shabab, is what? To enjoy the good and forbid the evil in the community. But once you see these four things happening in the community, فعليك بخاصة نفسك. You take care of yourself. ودع عنك أمر العوام. And forget about those, the general public, the عوام, the general people. What are these? And we will continue the hadith inshallah. But what are these four things? So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us to keep enjoining the good, forbidding the evil, not to give up on the community till four things would happen. If they happen, you take care of yourself and you ignore the general public. You leave them. What are these four things, ya shabab? And focus on them and see where we are from these four things. Okay? And again, I'll comment later on, but let me mention these four things. حتى إذا رأيت شحا مطاعا وهوى متبعا ودنيا مؤثرة وإعجاب كل ذي رأي برأيه. If you see these four things, focus on yourself, trash the people. فإن من ورائكم أيام الصبر. Ahead of you are the days of patience. Ahead of you, the days of patience. القابض على دينه. The one who is holding to his deen is like the one who is holding a piece of fire. So there are going to be a shabab the days. The one who is going to be holding to his deen is going to be holding to a piece of fire. There is still one sentence remaining in the hadith. But let me comment on these four things. What was number one, shabab? Ha, who memorized? What was number one? حتى إذا رأيت. Ha, what was number one? Where are my حفاظ of the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم? You listen, focus, you memorize. شحا مطاعا. شح means stinginess. مطاعا means obeyed. Which means you find people obeying their stinginess. You tell them, give for the sake of Allah, but they are stingy. They are holding back. Give money for the sake of Allah. Ah, brother, but But it is not only a shabab spending money. It is spending time and effort. Come to work. Now I'm going to be touching on some sensitive parts. Come to work in the land. Spend for the sake of Allah. I sleep, I wake up. Shuhad. This is stinginess. Stinginess, ya shabab, is not only whenever we are asking for money. Stinginess means you don't want to give for the sake of Allah. Whether it is your money, whether it is your effort, whether it is your time. شحاً مطاعاً. People are obeying their stinginess. You are stingy, you want to give time. You don't want to give effort. If it is hot, if it is sunny, if it is rainy, if it is tough situation, come and help us. You know this here. This is شحاً مطاعاً. Obeyed stinginess. وهوىً متبعاً. هوى. Desire. متبع, followed. People are following their desire, not following whatever Allah commanded them to do. In the old days, the shabab, or in the good days, people would put the desires away. What did Allah command me to do? Allah commanded me to wake up and pray fajr in jama'ah in masjid. I will do this. Or am I gonna follow my desire and sleep under my warm blanket? Are you gonna listen and obey to the commandments of Allah? Or are we listening to the desires? هَوَن مُتَّبَعًا. Oh, and then you do, you know, do you really ask what Allah commanded me to do? Or are you predetermined on what you will do? And it's easy to find the fatwa. Inshallah, we'll find the fatwa in a way or another. Or we don't care even about yani. You see, you can get someone to give you the fatwa you like. So are you following whatever Allah told you to do? Or are you following the desires? And later on, we will figure a way to get the fatwa. So the second one is what? هَوَن مُتَّبَعًا. Number three. ودنيا مؤثرة. دنيا is the dunya. مؤثرة means preference is given to dunya. Whenever, ya shabab, you see, for example, let me give you some examples so that you feel it. You would find someone spending the time in his job so that he would get money, so that he get promoted, But whenever you tell him, come and spend something for the sake of Allah or work for the sake of Allah, he would start the same pattern of brother, I will, you understand what I mean. So they give preference to the dunya. Even a shabab, many times your parents, out of their love for you and because they want to see you successful in your career, they tell you, finish your homework, don't go to Tamkeen to listen to the halaqa. But why? Why? This is yes, for sure. I would be the first one to tell you, be the best in your schools, be the best in your career, but you cannot afford dropping your deen. You cannot afford yawning whenever you are listening to the halakha of the deen. You see the point, shabab? Many times preference is giving to dunya, not to the deen. How many times parents would tell you, you cannot go to Tamkeen because you have exams. And it is not one or two, no, it is many cases, many cases. How many times parents would tell you, you cannot go help in Tamkeen till you finish whatever, cleaning the house or mowing the grass in our backyard or whatever. How many times they would tell you why you would go there and work for free? Anyway, lots of stuff, ya shabab. Whenever people are preferring the dunya over the deen, where are the people who would, if they know my time is needed for the sake of Allah, where are the parents who would say, go do something for the sake of Allah? We can wait. You know, there is a garbage saying being said, we grow in Egypt, with this sentence, very garbage sentence. For those who are coming from Egypt, I don't know if it is in Iraq or Jordan or any places. اللي يعوز البيت يحرم على الجامع. Who listened to this? Have you heard this in, do you say this
Jordan
in
Jordan? No, but I heard it in Egypt.
Have you heard of this in Egypt? اللي يعوز البيت يحرم على الجامع. Whatever is needed for your house is haram for the masjid. This is garbage. This is pure garbage, which means if your house needs your money, put your money in your house and give no charity to the masjid. If there's something needed in your house, give it to your house. It is haram to give it to the masjid if needed by your house. And then, yeah, whenever someone tells me this, and who narrated this? Someone who is stingy? Someone who is garbage stingy, who made the... For sure, no. We want to build the mentality. The house of Allah is first, and then my house is second. Doing something for the sake of Allah is first, and then my own family is second. If I do something for the sake of Allah, Allah will do better than I would have done for my family. Keep this in your mind, ya shabab. What is number three? Dunya mu'thara. And dunya that is getting the preference. People giving preference to dunya more than deen. What is the last one? And the last one is very dangerous. And the last one is really the most dangerous one. وَإِعْجَابُ كُلِّ ذِي رَأْيٍ بِرَأْيِهِ. And everyone is proud of his own opinion. Everyone loves his own opinion. In the good times, ya shabab, whenever we ask for an opinion, everyone, this is the good attitude. I'm going to be holding my opinion till I listen to the opinion of the sheikh, till I listen to the opinion of the parents, till I listen to the opinion of the elders, till I listen to the opinion of the people who have more knowledge. I would question my opinion. I would listen to the opinions of other people and try to align, fix my opinion according to the opinions of wise people. But nowadays you would find everyone has his own opinion and he's not willing to change his opinion. Everyone is well opinionated and everyone likes his own opinion. And everyone, you'll find some people, even they do not have the knowledge. They can hardly read the Fatiha. But this is my opinion. And it becomes tough, ya shabab, whenever some people, and more specifically at a young age, I remember, one of the sheikhs in the old days when he was criticizing the younger generation in the old days. He used to say, those younger generations are very quick. They are very opinionated, very quick in saying their opinion without their knowledge. Each one of them read only few hundreds of books and he's coming to debate with me. Did you get it or not? The Sheikh is criticizing the younger generation in the older days because the younger generation is bad. They only read few hundreds of books and they believe they have knowledge. How many hundreds of books have you read, ya shabab, before you become opinionated? In the old days, the criticism is those younger generation only read few hundreds of books and they are coming to argue and debate with me. If the Sheikh would come today and he would find some of the younger generations who cannot even read Al-Fatiha, who did not read any book, who forgot to read and write, and they want to argue for their opinion, I don't know how he would feel. فهي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, وإعجاب كل ذي رأي برأيه. So again, what are the four things, يا شباب, that if they happen, the advice of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is to shut down, give up, stay at your home, take care of yourself, forget about the people. It became a hopeless case. Huh? Who can repeat them again for me? What is number one? Yes. شحن مطاع. Obey the stinginess. What is number two? هوى متبع. ما شاء الله. هوى desire. Being followed. Number three. دنيا مؤثرة. Preference is giving to دنيا. Number four. إعجاب كل ذي رأي برأي. Everyone is opinionated and everyone he loves his opinion. When I was giving this khatara, shabab, to the girls before the hike, I was telling them, I'm not giving you this khatara in preparation of shutting down. This is not the intention. The intention is that we teach the younger generations how to be good so that we do not end up shutting down. If you take people who are 10 years old, 11 years old, 12, 13 years old, and then you start educating them about these diseases, you start educating them about these diseases, you tell them, do not be proud of your opinion. Question your opinion. Listen to the opinion of the elders. Make sure that whenever something is needed for Allah, you give preference to Allah and whatever Allah commanded you to do over your desire. I will not be sleeping two more hours in comfort in my bed while other people are working under the sun or under the rain to do something for the sake of Allah. Your goal, shabab, if you don't want to shut down, is to take care of these four dimensions. Make sure you are not stingy. If you are asked for something to do for the sake of Allah, whether money, effort, time, you give. Make sure you do not follow the desire. You sincerely ask, what did Allah want me to do? Do not say, I'm going to pray Fajr at home or whatever, and Allah Ghafur Rahim, and I'll figure out the fatwa later on. Or whatever it is, ya shabab. Make sure that you listen to the opinions of the elders. Whenever, ya shabab, these four ingredients happen in a community, and if you try to correct the community, two things can happen. The first one, if the people reach this level of these four bad characteristics, if you try to give them da'wah, it can bring negative effects, which means leave them without da'wah may be better. If you try to give them da'wah, they are gonna fight back and they are gonna go even to worse situation. You will tell them, this is what Allah said, but they have their own opinion. They are following their desire. They are giving preference to dunya. They are following their stinginess. They are gonna keep argue, and you are gonna be heating them up. They are gonna even go in a war situation and curse you and even curse the deen and do whatever. But if they reach this level, leave them. Giving them the da'wah is gonna drive them bad in war situation, and you will be attacked. You will definitely be attacked by this garbage community. They are gonna make rumors against you and so on. Make sense? And this is gonna be the time whenever you are holding to your deen, it is holding to a piece of fire. The hadith is concluded by the beautiful sentence that many of you already know. When he sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, the time will come holding your deen is like holding a piece of fire, he sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave this sentence. The reward of someone at that time equals the reward of 50 of you. You means whom? The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was addressing the companions and he said, أجر العامل منهم, the reward of someone doing deeds at that time is like 50 of you. The companions questioned the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam because they know they are the best. 50 of us or 50 of them? So if someone do good deed, is he gonna be like 50 of the companions? 50 of us or 50 of them? He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said 50 of you, the companions. Which means, Shabab, you have an amazing opportunity if you understand. If you understand, wallahi Shabab, whenever you hear there is something on sale, imagine for example, Shabab, what is something that instead of being with $50, it is with $1. Give me an example of something with, for example, $100. Earbuds for $100 that you love them. If I tell you they are on sale for $2.
Black Friday.
Yeah?
Black Friday.
Well, more than this. Imagine something, whatever you love. Whatever, a shirt or whatever, it is for $100 or technology or this, whatever. How much is this, Ibrahim? Probably you got it for $5, correct? Huh? 50. Oh, really? Imagine if I tell you this is for $1. So now, Shabab, wallahi, if you understand how much Allah is giving you an opportunity, I don't know if it is the correct sentence or not, but I'm saying the Jannah is on sale. But if you do not obey your stinginess, if we ask you, come and help, sit down at your home and do something for Tamki. How many responded to Qamhawi regarding helping in the treasury?
He said,
Habibi, he was making fun of you. My understanding, zero responded to him. He was making fun of you, Habibi. After he said a lot or before?
Before, I think.
Huh?
I don't know.
Yeah, I thought the one wanted to, no, how to deal with money.
Huh? He was making fun of you because probably not that. And you can double check, he may be coming here. But anyway, obey stinginess. Whenever, Shabab, we ask this land, alhamdulillah, you are here sitting here having your i'tikaf or playing archery or whatever. Ask yourself the question, how much did I help in this house? People were here in the middle of the snow and the vans or whatever, they were stuck over here and we were freezing to get this house and to build this house. Were you one of those who built this house? Do you know that whoever build a house for Allah, Allah will build him a house in Jannah? Can you imagine what it means, ya Shabab, house in Jannah? It all based on your belief and your trust in Allah. I know Allah, شباب, many of you. And I know, ask all the older ones who got some, whatever they did, some of those minimum wage job while they are students. And many of you may be doing this. Whenever it is a minimum wage job, even I know my son Noor himself, he should be coming. I can backbite him till he comes. He wakes up late. But whenever he was having a minimum wage job and they tell him come 6 in the morning or even before Fajr, he would wake up and he would go for minimum wage per hour. 15, 16, 17, whatever per hour it is. Don't you know that if you come here and build a house for Allah, Allah will build a house for you in Jannah. And who is the builder? It is Allah in, and it is in Jannah. Forget by any house that you have seen in dunya. Or whenever Allah says, Raka'ata al, this is hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Raka'ata al-Fajr. What does it mean, the two raka'a of Fajr? Raka'ata, the two raka'a of Fajr. Khayrun min ad-dunya wa ma fiha. Better than dunya and everything in it. Raka'ata al-Fajr, this is the sunnah of Fajr, not the fard. Raka'ata al-Fajr, this is the two raka'a sunnah before Fajr. And the reward of Fajr itself is more. If we believe, Jannah is on sale, shabab. If you do whatever you can, imagine, shabab, at a time where everyone is disobeying Allah, everyone is doing something haram, everyone believes his cool, everyone is doing his hair like Hamza and Yusuf and whatever, and they're going cool, and the ripped jeans and whatever, and we're cool and whatever. And you decide, no, but it is not me. I am a true servant of Allah. The reward of the one who is working at that time equals the reward of 50 of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You are getting an offer. Are you going to take it? Or are you going to leave it? Are you going to say, oh Allah, I am going to dedicate my life for your sake? Or am I gonna end up like anyone else? Get busy with dunya, busy with dunya, busy with dunya, busy with dunya, busy with dunya. Oops, I am 70 years old, I'm 75 or whatever you are, and I am on my deathbed. The amount of regret, ya shabab, at that time, if you didn't do anything for the sake of Allah, is huge. If you look back and you find all your contribution in dunya, I made money and I had fun and I spent the money having fun, it is not going to be an easy moment. It's going to be tough on you. But if you look back and you say, Alhamdulillah, I built the house of Allah over here. I worked for the sake of Allah. I took care of my brothers. I took care of all the younger generation. I made sure that I listen to Allah and not listen to my desires. Again, shabab, try to think of yourself. How far are you from these four things? And correct yourself. I'm not telling you this so that we say, okay, let's give up and shut down. But I'm telling you this so that we correct you at a young age so we do not end up shutting down. That was, a shabab, basically what I mentioned. But for sure I made it shorter because you know you cannot give a khatira before the hike for that long. At the end of the hike, I got many beautiful khatiras. And I hope, a shabab, that you, after Salat Fajr or some whatever, you start sharing deep khatiras. I will not mention all the khatiras I got from the girls, but subhanAllah, if I mention all of them, they are all worthy of mentioning. But there is one that really touched my heart a lot. And it was coming from one of the very young girls. One of the very young girls, whenever she gives such deep khatira, yani it makes a difference. while we're hiking, she fell down, and for sure, يعني إيه, she was trying to make a big deal of whenever she fell down, and she said, يعني إيه, this is her خاطرة. She said, I thought that I will go to Jannah because the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, من كان آخر كلامه, whoever his last words or the last of his speech is لا إله إلا الله, دخل الجنة. He would enter Jannah. So she said, I will make sure that before I die immediately, I'm gonna say لا إله إلا الله and I will enter Jannah. Are you okay, Abdullah? Getting too old or what? Your bones are... For me, I'm getting old, but I'm too, Abdullah, you're still too young for this, Habib. You still have few more years to say, يعني, yeah, still. So she said, I'll make sure to say, لا إله إلا الله before I die. So that it becomes my last words, and I will enter Jannah. Yes, I'm telling you, Anisha's young, this is how she was thinking. But then she said, but whenever I fell down, and I thought, I'm about to die, I forgot to say La ilaha illallah. I was screaming for help, I was whatever, but saying La ilaha illallah did not come to my mind. How can I make sure that whenever it is really my last second to say La ilaha illallah? And this is, ya shabab, how I responded to her. If you live all your life for La ilaha illallah, Allah will make you say La ilaha illallah before you die. But if you lived your life for stuff that is other than La ilaha illallah, you may not be able to say La ilaha illallah before you die. We see people at the deathbed. Even people are trying to remind them of La ilaha illallah, but on their deathbed, they keep saying, this is how much money I have. This is how much money in my bank account. This is such and such. My car, my house. Because he lived his life for his house, for his bank account. So whenever he's dying, it is whatever he cares for he's gonna be mentioning before his death. But if you live for La ilaha illallah, Allah will make you say La ilaha illallah before you die. And here is the ayah, shabab. يثبت الله الذين آمنوا بالقول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة. Allah would make the believers firm with the firm speech in dunya and in the hereafter. And some of the people in the tafsir refer to this قول ثابت, firm speech that Allah will give you in dunya, is to say this word at the time of death. And in the hereafter, whenever you are in the grave, and being questioned by the two angels. Really, the questions of the angels are easy if you write. You know, whenever some people go to the exam and they make a cheat sheet and they hide it in their pocket. So why don't you take this cheat sheet with you in your grave? What are the questions? Man Rabbuk? Allah. Easy, correct? Ma deenak? Islam. Very simple cheat sheet. But the question, shabab, the problem in the grave is not how easy the answers are. It is how scared you are, how dark the grave is, or how much light in your grave. How those angels are coming to you. How do they look like? If you lived for La ilaha illallah in dunya, Allah will make you firm in your grave. Whenever you are being questioned by the angels, Man Rabbuk? Allahu Rabbi.
But if someone didn't live for La ilaha illallah, man rabbak, huh? Huh? What you, and actually, this is the word, this is what is mentioned in the hadith is, he goes, huh? He is not able to answer. He is shocked to the level he cannot answer. So what this girl actually were able to spot that I was falling down. What if I was about to die from this fall? She was trying to make a big deal. It was not that much of a big fall or anything. But the khatara was very deep. I did not remember to say La ilaha illallah. Why? Are we going to be able, shabab, to say La ilaha illallah before our death or not? Is based on, are you going to live for La ilaha illallah? Or are you going to live for making money and having fun? Sounds good, shabab? You can make money to use the money for the sake of Allah. That's all I have for you, shabab. Anything, shabab? Anyone want to say anything, any echo back that I would love to hear from you before we end up our halaqa, shabab? Any reflections from your side? Any response to the khatira of that girl? A reflection based on what you see in Tamkeen, based on what you think. Are we on track for building the best generation that is gonna liberate al-Masjid al-Aqsa, bring our Khilafah back, and take care of the deen of the people? Or are we on track for these four characteristics and eventually shutting down? What do you think, shabab? Give me a few minutes kada for reflections. Yes, Muhammad. You enter Jannah.
And it's easy to memorize, but then...
How many memorize them?
Exactly, yeah.
Correct?
You have to constantly think,
yes,
about it.
And reciting Ayat al-Kursi after each Salah. Who is doing this after each Salah? Which means, if really you are not living for the sake of Allah, Allah will make you forget the 99 names of Allah before your death, or Allah will make you eventually drop Ayat al-Kursi after every Salah. Many deeds, he said, if you do this, you enter Jannah. But if you are not really in good relationship and sacrifice, willing to sacrifice for the sake of Allah, you will eventually forget. How many people memorize 99 names of Allah when they were young? Later on, when they grow up, they forgot them. بارك الله فيك محمد. Yes, Amjad.
Well, I'm gonna say what did I learn from before and how I counted. So exactly, it's like investing. So there's like an advice from the people: just give them money, like maybe $100 for a company, and just forget about it. And come after 30 years, you're gonna find it maybe like $1,000 or $1,000,000. So maybe if we think, if you start thinking about it in this way with Allah, that I'm gonna do an effort or money for a masjid or for building something for the sake of Allah, and just forget about it, and you're gonna find that this small thing, if it, whatever is it, is money or is it effort, you're gonna find it in Jannah, inshallah, for like just for you. You're gonna take it, and Allah is not gonna forget what did you did. But you're gonna forget, and you're gonna surprise about what you did in the dunya.
أحصاه الله ونسوه. Allah counted this, and they forgot. بارك الله فيك. Yes, Ibrahim.
I think the khatir made you remember the story that you said in the halaqa about the man who really wants to see Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم.
عليه الصلاة والسلام.
And the Sheikh had him have a lot of salt in his food, so he would be thinking of water. When he slept, he dreamt of rivers. I think it really just pushes the point that whatever you're, whatever's on your conscious, whatever you're really striving for, is what you're going to remember in your dreams and your last second.
Yes, the last second, correct. Barakallah fi gawrahim, yes. So whatever you live for, this is how you are gonna end your life. Jazakallah khair. Ah, who else, shabab? Yes, Abd al-Rahman.
So, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, the four qualities he mentioned, as I heard them, and then the Prophet said, when these four qualities appear, then like, just take care of yourself and know the people. Those four qualities, they're like exactly what would make someone not like listen to any advice. Because first one, if you ask them for something or like to spend time or money, they're going to be stingy. If you try to give them advice to Abu bin Auf and Nahi anil Munkar, they're going to follow their hala. If you try to remind them of the akhirah, they're going to give preference to the dunya. If you try to convince them of something, they're going to be
well-opinionated.
So like when you combine all those opinions, they're going to be like completely shut off from like any help, like someone tries to like advise.
Yes.
Or like give them any nasiha, they're not going to be able to listen.
Jazakallah khair, Abd al-Rahman. Actually, this is an amazing observation, because if these four characteristics, they happen, the doors of nasiha is closed. You try to give him a nasiha, but he likes his own opinion. Do this for Allah, he loves his own desire, or he give preference to dunya, or he is too stingy. Khalas, if these four things happen, doors for nasiha are closed. Jazakallah khair. Ha. Who else, shabab? Are you optimistic or are you pessimistic? Are you optimistic that you, every one of you, shabab, has a responsibility? Are you up for the job, that you really dedicate yourself for the sake of Allah? Or do you think we are on track for these four things to happen and then we shut down? How much? If you are optimistic that things are going to go in the right direction, raise up your hand.
Depending on the scope.
If you are pessimistic and you think, no, we cannot help so much, it's going to be on track for these four things, and it's better eventually to stay home, take care of yourself only, raise up your hand. Well, if you stuck there, it's better that you stay at home instead of pushing people away from this. Actually, what I liked from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whenever people understood the ayah initially, that we just take care of ourselves and give up on the people, he said, "Bali tamiru bil ma'roof." No, enjoying the good and forbid the evil. Till. So, the main thing that you start by enjoying the good and forbidding the evil. And make sure, shabab, you understand, if you try to go doing something and convincing the community to do something for the sake of Allah, you will be attacked, people are gonna spread rumors on you, people are gonna harm you. This is definitely known. This is why he sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, it is gonna be the time holding to your deen is like holding a piece of fire. Yes, Stefan.
I think like what you do depends on like the communities that you're in. Like for example, when we're here, like I mean the people here, the people like around us here in this community, they're not like Namkeen, they're not this bad. Like they're not gonna go and tell you no, your opinion is wrong, and they don't care about this and that. They're gonna listen, most of them. But like, for example, in other communities where maybe the it's like Islam is not at high, it's like lower levels, and they care more about dunya than the akhirah. And if you tell them, if you try giving them a nasiha, they're gonna tell you, no, my opinion better, and this is right, and you're wrong. And then yeah, and then you don't, then you should not give these type of people, this community, any nasiha. But like, we're here, and yeah, sure.
So say the community of Tamkeen is good, but the other community is not good?
I'm saying it depends on the community that you're in, like if you was running.
Yeah, definitely, yes. Or maybe any levels of how bad they are, yani being bad, it is, yes, Allah al-Musa'ad. Again, yani, we're trying. إِنْ أُرِيدُ إِلَّا الْإِصْلَاحَ مَا اسْتَطَعَتْ وَمَا تَوْفِيقِي عَلَيْهِ وإليه أنيب. بارك الله. Anything else, شباب؟
طيب